Thanks. Welcome everyone. Good afternoon. Thankfully, my session is not right after lunch, so hopefully you guys are awake and ready to listen, right? And hopefully this is an interesting topic. And it has Belarus in the topic, so hopefully that serves the purpose. Just a quick introduction. I'm Anurag, a vice president in the firm. Everest Group is a firm that focuses entirely on the global services space. As you can see, we've been more than 25 years in existence. We work with the large companies, even small and medium companies, helping them optimize their global operations, service delivery operations. So that's all we do. We do not do general management consulting or research. We focus on the global services space. Obviously, as the market grows, we keep moving with it. So we are focusing on the new trends, digitalization, automation, next-gen technologies. Our research tends to be quite data and fact-based. So we have an in-house team that track this information. We have databases that that help us be knowledgeable about stuff, right? So whatever we say in the market is backed up by some trends that we see in the market. And these are some of the trends that we will see today. Overall, we work with all elements of the value chain. So we work with service providers, helping them optimize their locations or operations, helping them with client targeting. Work with service enablers like one part of that is the country associations, the likes of NASCOM, IBPAP in the Philippines, Scotland Enterprise, South Africa, right? Plus the other technology providers such as SAP, right, Intel. We also work with the enterprises, which tends to be the bigger bucket for us. So you can see a sprinkling of financial services, there's manufacturing, there's healthcare, there's telecom, and so on. So we work with the entire spectrum of the market, and that helps us enrich what we say because we get input from all parts of the organization. I lead our practice around locations. So as part of my job, I need to know the difference between a Minsk and a Kiev or a Minsk and a Krakow, right? So I'm thankful to be here, thanks to Artyom and the wonderful organizers that make this trip possible. So thanks to that as well. Just moving on, what is the state of the global services market? Now, how do we define this market? This is essentially all of service delivery, except what is the domestic market. So a US company, let's say, servicing US demand in the US is not part of this. Okay. We're talking about services exports, right? And this includes all of IT, business process, contact center, engineering services, right? So wherever there is services delivery, that is part of this pie, right? What we're seeing is, if you look at how it has grown from 2011 to up till now, right, in terms of billion dollars, there's been a fair amount of growth. Keep in mind, this is still growing, although the pace of growth has slowed down a little bit in the past 1 or 2 years. Right? At the same time, we see there is huge potential in the market. Right? There are umpteens of companies that are yet to outsource or yet to offshore. Right? So there's huge demand that is still there in the market. Compared to where the market is right now, there is at least 2 or 3 times of that is untapped. Right? Also keep in mind, as we move towards the future, the potential market size may also grow. Right? We don't know yet what technologies may come into play. We don't know yet how enterprises and service providers will grow. So even this pie may actually become bigger as we go along. So net, there is a lot of potential yet in the global services market. Going on to how is this global services demand split, right? Where is the demand coming from? And this is just a look at outsourcing. We are not looking at in-house or captive delivery, right? This is just outsourcing to third-party providers. You can see easily North America is stable, right? Forms about 1/3 of the market. At one time, it was as big as 40% of the market, but the influence of North America is slowing down. Europe has become very important, right? So the combination of UK and continental Europe, you can see, although if at least in this view, it is declining. Before that, it was increasing. But if you you see, you know, nearly more than 40% of your market is now coming from Europe, right? So Europe is still a very large demand market. A lot of demand for outsourcing comes from Europe. There is growth in the rest of the world, yes. But overall, if you see the total number of transactions, this is a view of number of transactions, not of dollar value, right? Look at number of transactions that is probably slowing down or stable. But keep in mind, this is all new growth, right? This is not renewals, this is all new deals. So although the growth is slowing down, there is still a lot of growth. We move forward keeping that in mind and look at the other part of the market, which is in-house delivery, right? Which is companies, enterprises setting up their own captive or shared services in offshore markets and nearshore markets. As you look at that, on the left you see the number of setups, and number of new setups and expansions of captive centers or shared services. You see there's been an explosion in that, right? There's a reason for that. One, as enterprises grow more complex, they want to keep some of the secret sauce or things that are closer to the core of the organization in-house, right? So they don't want to be sharing their secret sauce with other providers that may also share again in turn with other enterprises or other providers, right? So they want to keep the core with them. Also, not just because of the sharing angle, but also because they want more control over it, right? So they want to be able to say, okay, from tomorrow, these five guys will focus on a new part of the market, which is difficult to do with the provider actually. Right? At the same time, new enterprises are inspired by the success of other companies in the shared services model and are adopting the shared services model. Right? So there's a lot of growth. Look into this growth. A lot of it is driven by new companies setting up shared services. Right? And thirdly, as companies look at the digitalization and look at automation, they feel some of this work is complex, niche, that it needs to be done in-house. I need to have control over it, right? So that is one big reason driving this. And then finally, a lot of companies are now setting up centers of excellence where they want to do complex work for even traditional services like finance and accounting, or HR, or IT, and BM. So all in all, there is a huge growth in shared services model. Again, this is not saying this has to necessarily impact the outsourcing market negatively. In the past, both models have kept growing in hand, right? So a lot of companies, actually, I would say 90% of the companies are not wedded to a model. They leverage both models simultaneously. There's a difference in how much and the skew, right? But most organizations tend to go with best of breed and pick what they want for different kinds of things. The other point I want to make on this page is some of the more complex kind of work, especially IT services, is growing in the shared services model. In the past, we've seen mostly the shared services. Okay, let me put it under. In the past, most of the outsourcing was around IT, if you were to generalize things for a bit. And most of the in-house delivery was with contact center and shared, business process work. This is changing rapidly. A lot of companies are now pulling in and insourcing work in IT as well, and setting up IT service centers. Again, driven by digitalization, automation, where there is more technology play. So that is one significant point, I think, for the Belarus market to keep in mind. Let's move along. If you look at we looked at the demand market so far, right? What is the demand for outsourcing and what is the demand from shared services delivery, right? In-house delivery. Now we look at the supply side of the house, right? Where is service delivery happening outside the domestic market, right? So forget US being serviced from US, but if US is exporting, or if you look at the entire exports market globally, where is the supply happening? Asia Pacific continues to be strong, although you can see the share is dipping rapidly, right? If you look at the entire pie, the pie is growing considerably as well. So it means that although in an absolute sense Asia Pacific is growing, the relative share is actually dipping, right? What is taking Asia Pacific's place in the market is nearshore Europe, right? You can see within a space of 2 years, the share of nearshore Europe is defined as Central Eastern Europe plus nearshore UK, which is Ireland, Scotland, Northern Ireland, right? So this is all the delivery locations that are servicing Western Europe in a nearshore kind of context. So nearshore Europe is actually booming, right? That's a significant point for the Belarus market to keep in mind as well. Yes, there are other points around Latin America, Caribbean also growing, but at a much lesser pace. And others is relatively stable. Others includes the Canada, African region, and the Middle East region. So overall, if you look at number of people employed in service delivery, the point that is nearshore Europe is rapidly growing, right? And this is this is the reason why it is growing. If you look at the number of new delivery centers set up, and this is across IT, business process, contact center, you can see easily the share of nearshore Europe is exploding, right? If you can see, if you compare it to Asia Pacific or Latin America, Caribbean, they're all either stable or dipping, but nearshore Europe is definitely growing. And this is all contributing to the change in skew and the change in mix, nearshore Europe becoming more and more important increasingly in the global delivery structure. Just a recap of what we have seen so far. Global services market growing rapidly, maybe slowing down a bit, but still growing. There's a large untapped opportunity, so lots to go, lots for new markets to capture. Second point, Europe is a significant demand geography, again very important for Belarus. Third, nearshore Europe is a, I would say, increasingly more preferred location for delivery, right? Which means that there is more acceptance of a nearshore model and keeping work in Europe. And also, in a way, being ready to spend more to access better skills. Essentially, that's what it comes boils down to, right? Ultimately, cost and access to talent become the two most important parameters why companies make decisions. And then finally, increasing preference for in-house delivery, right? Especially driven by digital services. The other point I probably missed is multifunctional centers, right? If you look at where the industry is going with automation and digitalization, it makes sense for more companies to spread the kind of functions they're delivering in their centers. It helps the cause of automation and digitalization if you have domain experts for technology and operations and other things sitting in the same location. So there's a growth in multifunctional centers that we see happening. Now switching gears a little bit again and saying, how does Belarus or Minsk compare to all of this, right? This is Everest Group's MAP matrix, right? This is basically what we to compare the value propositions of locations, right? We segment locations into leaders, major contenders, and aspirants, right? On a talent and cost comparison, right? Talent includes entry level and experience pool weighted to the relevant degree, and operating cost is essentially fully loaded cost of delivery from that region, right? This is not to say that the leaders are the best locations and our aspirants are the worst locations, right? On the other hand, what we convey to the market is, depending on what your needs and objectives are, any of the locations from any of the segments may make sense, right? So a Ho Chi Minh city actually may make sense for you if you want to support China, or you want to support Japanese language, or you want to do small scale delivery of, let's say, gaming and animation sector, right? So that's what the strengths of the market are. So look at it that way, and then if you look at the leaders, obviously there is the India, and this is at a city level, right? And this is IT ADM, software development and maintenance. Obviously the Indian cities, the tier one cities like Bangalore, Mumbai, New Delhi, they will be the leaders in that due to their sheer size. If you look at the major contenders bucket, you see a bunch of nearshore Europe and nearshore Americas, which is basically Latin America, Caribbean, and Central Eastern Europe. And then finally, aspirants is a sort of a sprinkling of everything. The net message here is that Minsk punches above its weight. If you look at the size of the market from an entry level pool and an experience pool perspective, there is a fair bit of growth in the market, fairly large size, comparable to the likes of the big centers in Poland or Moscow, right? This is at a city level, keep that in mind. So net Minsk appears to be one of the front runners in the market, you know, in a global delivery context for IT ADM services, right? Now, moving on, what are the key opportunities for the market from Everest Group's perspective, right? And I'd be happy if one of some of you disagree and we can have a debate around this, right? One, very strongly we believe because of its strength in software development and product development, we believe there's a very big role that Belarus or Minsk can play to power digitalization in Europe. All the enterprises, all the conferences that we go to, everywhere, the key topic of discussion is digitalization and automation. We believe that a location with the strengths that Belarus has will have a big role to play in this market, right? So that's one key opportunity. The other is a part of the market that is not so big right now, which is the in-house delivery shared services, right? So we believe that there is enough potential in the market to support European IT shared services or become IT hub for even large providers, right? Second key opportunity, we see that because of your market pickup and synergies with, let's say, IT infrastructure or IT operations, and increasing the role of, let's say, DevOps, right, where technology development and operations will go side by side, we believe there's a big role for Belarus in the IT operations and infrastructure part of the market. And I'm pretty sure, although we've probably not done enough analysis on that, there may be a large part of the talent market which is not employable in the software development market, right? But they may still be able to contribute to the IT infrastructure and operations part of the market. So that's the second one. And the third is, may not resonate with this conference, but we also believe that due to the shift towards multifunctional and in-house delivery, we believe that having business process services in the mix will also be interesting, right? And I'm pretty sure that there are parts of the market that are servicing this region or the country in business process services. So that's one other area, along with the engineering services, where we believe that there's a, again, synergies between engineering and product and software development. So these are the three areas where we believe that Belarus has opportunities in increasing play in the global services market. And then finally, we have these three imperatives that we believe stakeholders in the Belarus market need to look more closely towards, right? One is how do you identify the stories and the successes that companies are having in the market, right? So there has to be a more consistent, I think going back to what Kirill also said, right? There needs to be more done by the government and probably there needs to be a central investment promotion agency or an investment promotion body that needs to track the market and at the same time with consistent frameworks, right? So not say 1 year we are talking about the overall market, the other year we are talking about exports market. So has to be a consistent tracking of the market and growth in the market, right? That needs to then go out to stakeholders. It needs to be informed, right? There needs to be more regular reporting done by the market and by the agencies to the outside world, right? In the same line, some of the success stories that companies are having had in terms of being able to access niche talent or growth that they are having in the market or the talent market that supports it needs to be shared more with the outside world. To be honest, in a lot of conversations in the past 3-4 years that we've had with clients, they don't really understand the value proposition of Minsk, right? So obviously this is skewed by the fact that we've been talking to mostly the American and the Western European companies, right? But there is a need for Belarus to be open and target that part of the world as well. They're already doing that. So yes, some of the success stories need to go out in the market, need to be told more, circulated more. And then on the measure side, you have also this identifying niche opportunities, again going back to increasing focus on digitalization and automation and the kind of talent opportunities and demands it is creating. It is very important to keep track of that and sort of keep telling the market that there is such talent available there. And then finally, support this industry. I think going back to again what Kirill mentioned, there needs to be investment in development of talent. I saw the chart around shortfall, that's pretty interesting. So there needs to be more done to bridge that shortfall. So train more people. If it is language that is preventing them from working in some of these companies, it is actually maybe a bridge course, right? Or maybe more collaboration between industry and academy. And so all of that can happen. And then finally, incentives around maybe tax rebates or education incentives or training incentives that can actually promote talent growth and more investment to come in to the country. That's where I will end the presentation, and happy to take any questions.